Good evening. Our reading this evening is from 2 Chronicles, chapter 36. 2 Chronicles 36. And we begin to read at verse 15. The Lord, the God of their fathers, sent word to them through his messengers again and again, because he had pity on his people and on his dwelling place. But they mocked God's messengers, despised his words, and scoffed at his prophets, until the wrath of the Lord was aroused against his people, and there was no remedy. He brought up against them the king of the Babylonians, who killed their young men with the sword in the sanctuary, and spared neither young man nor young woman, old man or aged. God handed all of them over to Nebuchadnezzar. He carried to Babylon all the articles from the temple of God, both large and small, and the treasures of the Lord's temple, and the treasures of the king and his officials. They set fire to God's temple and broke down the wall of Jerusalem. They burned all the palaces and destroyed everything of value there. He carried into exile to Babylon the remnant who escaped from the sword, and they became servants to him and his sons until the kingdom of Persia came to power. The land enjoyed its Sabbath rests. All the time of its desolation it rested, until the 70 years were completed in fulfillment of the word of the Lord spoken by Jeremiah. In the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia, in order to fulfill the word of the Lord spoken by Jeremiah, the Lord moved the heart of Cyrus, king of Persia, to make a proclamation throughout his realm and to put it in writing. This is what Cyrus, king of Persia, says: The Lord, the God of heaven, has given me all the kingdoms of the earth, and he has appointed me to build a temple for him at Jerusalem in Judah. Anyone of his people among you, may the Lord his God be with him, and let him go up.
Praise to his name is high.
if you stay with me over the next 9 months, we're going to look at one theme and hopefully see how it all fits together. We'll be looking at God's purposes for the entire creation in the light of Jewish history from 587 BC, the fall of Jerusalem to Babylon, right up to 70 AD, the fall of Jerusalem to the Romans, and all the implications that flow from that. Well, there'll be some history, there'll be some theology, there'll be some speculation even, and there'll be some exhortation, because this is a sermon and not a lecture. So our first topic tonight is God, Babylon, and the fall of Jerusalem. God, Babylon, and the fall of Jerusalem. In the chapter 36 there that we read from 2 Chronicles, we have the last 25 years of the nation state of Judah. At that time, the Middle East was in turmoil. Perhaps it always is, always will be. The Assyrians had defeated and deported the northern kingdom of Israel about 100 years before. But the Assyrian power was waning fast. And the new kid on the block was Babylon. And in that power vacuum between the decline of Assyria and the rise of Babylon, a third power slipped in, Egypt. Egypt began to flex its muscles. King Josiah met his death at the hand of an invading Egyptian army. Then a popular movement in Judah put a new king on the throne, only to see him deposed by the Egyptians and carted off to Egypt. And the Egyptians put a new king in Judah, Jehoiakim. But their power grab in the Middle East didn't last. In 2 Kings 24, we read, "The king of Egypt did not march out from his own country again, because the king of Babylon had taken all his territory from the Wadi of Egypt to the river Euphrates." So Babylon took over the Middle East. Nebuchadnezzar ascended to the throne of Babylon in 605 BC and became its greatest king. And he did big things in Judah. In 605, he captured its king, Jehoiakim, and deported a number of the high nobility and their offspring into Babylon, including Daniel. And you know from your reading of the book of Daniel that Daniel and his friends were well treated. They were housed, they were educated, they were fed, and Nebuchadnezzar wanted to use them in his civil service. Then, about 10 years later, Nebuchadnezzar deposed the next king of Judah, Jehoiakim. And he was taken to Babylon, and with him this time, all the useful citizens of Judah. They're named in 2 Kings, the administrators, the soldiers, the traders, the artisans, and among these was Ezekiel. So already, 10 years before the destruction of Jerusalem, there were many thousands of Jews living in Babylon and in the empire. Yes, displaced persons, but living useful and prosperous lives. And then in 587 BC came the end of Jerusalem, and the end was terrible. The siege lasted for 3 years, and it was total war. Chapter 36, verse 17. The king of the Babylonians killed their young men with the sword in the sanctuary and spared neither young man nor young woman, old men, old women. They all went total war. And over the years, war hasn't changed very much. Look at your television screens. You will see it all happening millennia later. And the suffering of the population was great. Yes, the temple was destroyed, the city was destroyed, the palaces were destroyed, and the people suffered, and the land was left almost empty. We are told the land enjoyed its Sabbath rest. All the time of its desolation, it rested. The land wasn't cultivated, the land rested, because the population had been deported, killed or deported to Babylon. And so the land of Judah was almost empty. One historian has written this: the destruction of Jerusalem and the subsequent exile marked the great watershed of Israel's history. At a stroke, her national existence was ended, and with it all the institutions in which her corporate life had expressed itself. They would never be recreated in precisely the same form again. Israel was left for the moment an agglomeration of uprooted and beaten individuals. And yet it was God's doing. If you look at chapter 36, verse 16, where it says, "The wrath of the Lord was aroused against his people." The wrath of the Lord was aroused. And as the writer to the Hebrews says in chapter 10, it is a dreadful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. The appalling end of Jerusalem gives us a horrifying picture of the judgment of God. We don't like it. We can, and many do, call it barbaric, call it primitive, call it pre-Christian. We can claim that God isn't like that, that God is love. Yes, he is love, but you can see God's loving concern for his people here in verse 15 of chapter 36. The Lord, the God of their fathers, sent word to them through his messengers again and again, because he had pity on his people and on his dwelling place. But love is not the totality of God's character. If you cast your mind back a few centuries to Moses, and Moses, if you remember, asked to see the glory of God. And the glory of God passed before him while Moses was hidden in a cleft in a rock. And as the Lord passed in front of Moses, he heard these words: the Lord, the compassionate and gracious, God, slow to anger, abundant in love and faithfulness, maintaining love to thousands, and forgiving wickedness, rebellion, and sin. Yet he does not leave the guilty unpunished. Now the emphasis there in Exodus 34, the emphasis, what comes first? The Lord is slow to anger. He's abounding in love and faithfulness. He forgives wickedness, rebellion, and sin. Yes, but yet punishment happens because God is just and righteous. And yet when it happens, it's almost with reluctance. God is reluctant to execute judgment. It's a sort of last resort. In Isaiah 28, speaking of a certain judgment of God, This is what Isaiah says. As surely as I live, declares the Sovereign Lord, I take no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but rather that they turn from their ways and live. And Isaiah writes that the Lord will rouse himself and do his work, his strange work, and perform his alien task. Judgment is a foreign work, a strange work. It's almost an alien work. And yet, God judges because he's just. Sin cannot go unpunished. In 2 Peter chapter 3 in the New Testament, the Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting any to perish, but that everyone should come to repentance. In his mercy, God did what he could for Judah. Again and again, he sent them his messengers. Again and again, he spoke to them. And in mercy, God has sent his son Jesus to save us from the inevitable consequences of our own sin and rebellion against God. You shall call his name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sin, from the consequences of their sin. For God so loved the world, that he sent his Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Because Jesus lived for us, because Jesus took our sin, because Jesus bore God's wrath upon himself for that sin, we can be delivered from the wrath to come and enjoy fellowship with God in God's new creation. As Isaiah 53 reminds us, surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering. Yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. But there comes a point when there is no remedy. Look what happened in Judah. God sent his messengers again and again, verse 16. But they mocked God's messengers, despised his words, scoffed at his prophets, until the wrath of the Lord was aroused against his people, and there was no remedy. And it's not just Judah, is it? There will be a day of judgment for our world. God has appointed a day when he will judge the world. And daily he is warning us in his word, written and preached. He is warning us in events. The COVID crisis surely is a warning trumpet from God. We are not in control. Life is uncertain. Be prepared to meet your God. Climate change is another warning. Our greed and our covetousness is pulling the sky down on our heads. There was no remedy. God could do no more. What more can God do for us than he has done in Jesus his Son? You see, there is a tragedy in ignoring, in marginalizing, in dumbing down the good news about Jesus. There's a fascinating translation in the NIV of Jonah, chapter 2 and verse 8. Those who cling to worthless idols forfeit the grace that could be theirs. Those who cling to worthless idols forfeit the grace that could be theirs. They miss out. They cling to the idols instead of availing themselves of grace. And how true that can be of us. We cling on to our health, we cling on to our wealth, we cling on to this world and the things of this world and everything that goes with it. We cling on to our worthless idols. And we think that Jesus is nothing to do with us. We cling on. I'm sure you all know the Lord of the Rings. We are all little golems. You know, Gollum, the creature who was possessed by his precious, that ring. He pursued it and eventually he captured it. His precious, that's what he wanted above all else. And in possessing it at the end, in clutching onto it, in hanging onto it, he fell into the cracks of doom. It was disaster. Those who cling to worthless idols forfeit the grace that could be theirs. We cling on to such meaningless things, such empty things. It can be disastrous. Was with Jerusalem. There was no remedy. So judgment came. But notice, the chronicler doesn't stop with judgment. We read in verse 22, in the first year, Cyrus, king of Persia, in order to fulfill the word of the Lord spoken to Jeremiah, the Lord moved the heart of Cyrus to make a proclamation. And he made a proclamation, urging the Jews to go back to Jerusalem and to build the temple again, to set up a little state. A few years later, Ezra was praying. And this is what Ezra prays. Chapter 9. From the days of our ancestors until now, our guilt has been great. Because of our sins, we and our kings and our priests have been subjected to the sword and captivity, to pillage and humiliation at the hand of foreign kings, as it is today. But now, for a brief moment, the Lord God has been gracious in leaving us a remnant and giving us a firm place in his sanctuary. Our God has not forsaken us in our bondage. He has shown us kindness in the light of the kings of Persia. He has granted us new life to rebuild the house of our God and repair its ruins. So how could this be? How could this happen? How could the Jews go back? How could the state be reinvented? The wages of sin is death. God had pronounced judgment, and yet here are the exiles going home. Did God change his mind? Did he, after all, pardon their sins and let them go? Lamentations is a book that gives us the reflections of a survivor who lived through the sack of Jerusalem. Lamentations chapter 3. I am the man who has seen affliction by the rod of the Lord's wrath. He has driven me away and made me walk in darkness rather than light. Indeed, he has turned his hand against me again and again, all day long, verse after verse, chapter after chapter, full of grief and self-pity. And then suddenly, chapter 3, 21, yet this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. In the midst of his grief and loss and suffering, the survivor remembers God's love. That great Hebrew word, hesed, God's covenant love, the love that God promised again and again to have for his people. The survivor of Jerusalem has hope because God promised good to his people. And therefore, because God was God, he would fulfill his word. Many died Many died, but a remnant were delivered. God's displaced people in Babylon had hope, had a future, because God was just and would put up with their sin for a while, because one day Messiah would come and everything would be paid for. Romans chapter 3, 25. God presented Christ as a sacrifice of atonement. He did this to demonstrate his righteousness, because in his forbearance he had left the sins committed beforehand unpunished. So Jesus paid the price of the sins that were overlooked in the past. The continuation and future of the Jews after the exile was grounded entirely in the grace and covenanted love of God. And similarly, although we as God's people deserve destruction, Jesus bore God's wrath for us. Romans 3, 25 and 26 again. God presented Christ as a sacrifice of atonement through the shedding of his blood, and he did it to demonstrate his righteousness at the present time, so as to be just and the one who justifies those who have faith in Jesus. So the cross is retrospective as well as prospective. It goes backwards as well as forwards. But the point is, Paul says in 1 Thessalonians 1, Jesus rescues us from the coming wrath. Does it tongue end him? This, the power of the cross, Christ became sin for us, took the blame, bore the wrath. We stand forgiven at the cross. Paul says, Romans 8, there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. The old hymn writer, the terrors of Lord and of God with me can have nothing to do. My Saviour's obedience and blood hide all my transgressions from view. And the hymn we sang before we started our service there. Because the sinless Saviour died, my sinful soul is counted free. For God the just is satisfied to look on him and pardon me. Judgment Day came to Jerusalem. Judgment Day is coming to us, not upon a nation, but upon the entire world. For we have got it wrong. We have got it all wrong in God's sight. And the wrath of God will be revealed against all unrighteousness, just as it was in Jerusalem long ago. But all sinners who believe in and trust the Lord Jesus Christ will be delivered from it. Having faith in Jesus' sacrifice for us is our one and only hope. A little bit of doggerel that I think of often. Perhaps these things become more important as one gets older, as one gets nearer the end. Upon a life I did not live, upon a death I did not die, I stake my whole eternity. Because Jesus died, I can live. So can you. Let's pray. It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. Your judgment on Jerusalem was terrible. Your judgment on our world will be equally terrible. But Lord, we thank you. We thank you that you sent your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, to rescue us from the coming wrath. We thank you that he bore the wrath to set us free. Lord, we thank you that Jesus paid it all. Lord, help us to look to him. Help us to count on him. Help us to follow him and to love him. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.